Thanks, everyone. Well, hello. Thanks for coming this evening. My name's Tom Conheny. I'm the new incoming board president, and I really appreciate everybody coming. Yeah, Tom Main finally got that lasso around me and pulled me in for good. I appreciate everybody coming out on such a rainy night, so thank you very much. Most importantly, right, while we're all excited to be here for the state of the school, tonight's the beginning of our 150th anniversary, right? Or a word that I just recently learned, I guess about a year ago now since we started talking about it, it's our sesquicentennial celebration. So, and I have to say sesquicentennial about three or four times tonight, so bear with me when I screw it up, okay? Well, look, seriously, you know, when we think about our sesquicentennial, and you can see it around the campus, we think about legacy, we think about strength, and we think about pride. So this evening, we're going to make our discussions around those three words. Kim Leaker will talk about strength in terms of our financial position as a school, Kim being the CFO and associate head of our school. I'm going to discuss legacy. I'm going to talk about, as parents, how can we leave a legacy behind? And Tom Main, head of school, Tom's going to come up and talk about pride. And when we think about pride here at King, we think about pride in terms of program, programmatic offerings, and programmatic strength. And Tom will take you through that. So first, Ben's worked very hard on this. First, we're going to kick things off with a short video. This is going to give you a quick glimpse into the history of King and really think about our mission-driven culture.
How can we best serve students with a combination of these three schools? Each time we've added another school, that's been the question. Well, Haywood brought to the table a dedicated interest in girls' education. King brought the male point of view. Thomas brought to the table the world around them. Each of the schools at their time contributed something. I don't think anything was lost in combining, only gained. It's still all about kids and their individual becoming.
We have 700 kids in this school. Each one of them is really pretty different from the next. Knowing them very well is not enough. Knowing them cognitively, understanding where they are developmentally, is what sets us apart. So being a school that works for those kids because we value what they are as individuals, as learners, as community citizens, as artists, as athletes, it's all incredibly important and not an easy thing to do. We are not thinking of education as a simple thing.
One, two, three, four, ten.
King has really helped me through my first year. At the end of the day, I have some free time and I don't want to just sit home and do nothing. I want to go out and help people. I want to give back as much as I can, and all the times that they've helped me, I want to help them.
If you have something that you're interested in, just never be embarrassed about it. Everyone here will accept you for who you are, and there will always be someone who you can relate to.
You'll probably learn something that you didn't know before, learn a way to fix something, learn a way to make something more efficient. Being excited to learn something new, it's going to be really important.
In order to really strive and be a part of society after you leave King, you're going to need to have some sort of global awareness.
You know, we learn about all these different places and we talk about issues concerning the world in a lot of classes actually. Learning about them in class is an amazing step, but like the trips are like a step further. They're really bringing you to experience
because you can,
the
like,
rest of the world that we wouldn't be able to see.
So it's gonna be like an opportunity to create a bond that you're gonna remember throughout high school. It opens your eyes.
It's always been all about the individual. And of course, now that grew out of a group of students that we had early on who were real winners in the very beginning. That grew into what King does now almost for every kid. The school's strengths now are the breadth and quality of the educational experience.
I think this is really a golden age for King when thinking about everything the school has accomplished, not just in the last 15 years, but in 150 years. This school has made it through incredible ups and downs, world wars, the Depression, and now is in really its finest hour. This is a wonderful place for children to grow up. This is a place that has the values, that has the virtues, that has the caring commitment, that provides a community that is really healthy for kids to grow up.
Welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining us this busy first week of school. I am Kim Leaker, Chief Financial Officer and Associate Head, and I will finish my portion of the program in less than 10 minutes. Tonight, I'm going to give a brief overview of our key financial indicators and progress against our strategic goals. Just a few items I'd like to highlight first. First of all, King is in an extremely fortunate and strong financial position. Second, we, meaning the board, the finance committee, and the administration, are very proactive in our financial management. We develop balanced annual operating budgets. We look at our financials on a multi-year basis, 5 to 10 years out. We look at various scenarios and sensitivities, and the strategic plan is incorporated into our financial planning. And last, this is a housekeeping item. To avoid confusion tonight when I'm referencing my fellow speakers, both named Tom, Tom Kahaney will now be referred to as Tom C, and Tom Main will be referred to as Tom Main. So, just keeps it straight. So, for 2015-16, we are entering this year with a balanced budget, which will allow us to continue to offer an excellent program and continue to progress against our strategic goals. Our operating budget, as you can see, is $27 million. And as you will see on the slide, the majority of our revenue, 88%, comes from net tuition and fees. The remaining 12% of our revenue primarily comes from two non-tuition sources. 9% comes from the annual fund, and there'll be more on that later. And 3% comes from a draw from our general endowment. In both areas, this money is put to immediate use and allows us to continue to enhance our tuition dollars to provide an even stronger educational experience and at the same time achieve our strategic needs. I will speak to more to this later, as will Tom C. But we work hard to balance the budget, so growth in our non-tuition revenue sources, both the annual fund and our endowment, is a key component in our strategic plan. On the expense side, also a total of $27 million, it will come as no surprise that we are people intensive, as 66% of our expenses are attributable to the salary and benefits of our 156 faculty and staff members. The program expenses, which are 10% of the budget, include operating expenses for our educational programs. This includes the athletics and arts programs, textbooks, computer science and digital applications, and division-specific programs. Administrative costs at 7% includes costs such as insurance and expenses for the admissions, advancement, and community affairs offices. Plant maintenance of 8% is for buildings and grounds maintenance and utilities costs. These are largely our fixed expenses. And the remaining 9% is for capital expenditures. Those are primarily associated with building and grounds improvements, security, and technology. So as I showed in the expense chart, faculty compensation and benefits is a significant portion of our expenses. It's over $17 million. We annually benchmark our compensation against our peer schools, and King offers a very competitive compensation and benefits package, which helps us to attract, retain, and support our excellent faculty. In addition, we have a detailed faculty performance review system with a merit component. And to emphasize our strong benefits package, we also put a strong emphasis on faculty development programs, including both the successful summer sabbatical program as well as the graduate study program. Last year in the graduate study program, we had 10 faculty members pursuing master's degrees and one pursuing a PhD. And the best example I can provide of the significance of this program is an email, unsolicited, that we received yesterday from someone who just recently completed their master's degree. It said, "I just wanted to share my sincerest thank you to King for providing me the opportunity to further my education through King's Graduate Studies program. Grad school was an amazing experience, an experience that granted me more knowledge in my subject, exposed me to various teaching methodologies, placed me in a student perspective, and rekindled my purpose as a science educator. Again, thank you." In addition to these two programs, there's also professional growth and development spending, and we're very pleased that we continue to be a leader among the Fairchester schools in PG&D. We are consistently at the top of the list of schools in terms of PG&D spending. And the programs and conferences that I've listed are just a few examples of the many opportunities for faculty to apply their learning and experiences from these conferences to the classroom. Now, switching gears a bit, consistent with our strategic plan and our facilities master plan, we have transformed the campus over the last 12 years. Some of you have been here to see it, others of you have seen parts of it, others of you probably haven't seen much of the transformation. But these improvements were completed with a combination of fundraising from generous donors as well as operating funds. This includes two new buildings, the middle school and this building, the PAC, both the north and south fields, significant landscape improvements such as the lower school playground and courtyard and the area in front of the middle school that we completed this summer, and of course the area we're in earlier this evening, the upper school reconfiguration that was actually done over a period of three summers. With these facilities comes the additional financial responsibility of properly maintaining them, and we plan for that accordingly as well. Financial aid is $2.5 million, reaching 13% of the student body. The majority of this, 95% of this, is funded through the operating budget. The remaining 5% is funded through endowed funds and outside funds. Tom C. will speak to this in greater detail later, but consistent with the strategic plan, we need to increase the endowed portion of aid, and we look forward to the 150th anniversary as one of the opportunities to do so. Annual fund. You saw that annual fund contributed a very important 9% to our funds for operations, and continued growth in this number is critical to supporting expanded programs for our students and meeting our strategic plan objectives. Annual fund money is used to support program offerings for the current year. The annual fund supports the competitive salaries, benefits, and professional growth and development opportunities that I spoke to before, all of which we need to attract and retain great faculty members. The annual fund supports teaching and learning at King. And the annual fund supports the educational experience for all students, visiting artists and guest speakers for the community. And in all three divisions, service learning opportunities such as the New Orleans service trip, student attendance at conferences, and classroom technology such as Lego robotics or film studio and animation equipment. So where do we stand now? 2014-15 was another great year for the annual fund, thanks to your generous gifts and the hard work of so many people, including 90-plus volunteers. You contributed over $2.3 million, a 19% over last year. We set participation records among new and existing families, and we once again had 100% participation from our faculty and staff and the Board of Trustees. As Tom C. will echo, we plan on continued growth in this number as a necessary component to support our goals in the strategic plan. This year's annual fund goal is $2.5 million, and we have every confidence that we will meet or perhaps exceed this number thanks to all of you. The Board and Investment Committee, along with our outside investment manager, devote a tremendous amount of time and energy to prudently managing the endowment. The endowment is what ensures the long-term financial sustainability and strength of King, as well as provides a draw to enhance our operating budget in areas such as faculty, financial aid, and programs. The current value of King's endowment, as you can see, is $22.2 million. It's composed of a general endowment of $19 million and a scholarship and program fund of $3.2 million. We do have just over $8 million remaining in 30-year debt, which was issued when we built the middle school in 2003. The interest rate on this debt is very favorable, and we continue to pay the required principal payments. So when you include this debt, you can see that our net endowment is $13.8 million. As you will hear from Tom C., increasing the endowment is absolutely a priority in the strategic plan. This, combined with the annual fund, these are the two areas where we can dramatically increase non-tuition funds to allow us the financial flexibility to do so much more. More programs for our students, increase faculty salaries, more opportunities for faculty professional growth and development, support the small class sizes, and quite simply, expand the educational experience for all of the students. In summary, we have made tremendous progress, and we are in a very fortunate financial position. But it does not stop here. We will continue to remain proactive, achieving our strategic goals, providing an excellent program, and ensuring the financial sustainability of King. Next, Tom C., our board president, will speak about legacy. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of the evening.
Well, first of all, thanks, Kim. Thanks for that excellent job. Ben, are you ready? All right. Well, hello again, everybody. My wife, Roseanne, and I have been at King since 2003. We have three children, Tommy, James, and Kelly. Tommy and James graduated last year and are off to college, and Kelly's a sophomore this year. And of course, you know, it's a little lonely at the house without having those two personalities around. But Roseanne and I are very confident that King has them well prepared for the challenges that they'll certainly face at college. And so that gives us tremendous solace. But people are always asking me, especially over the last 3 weeks, you know, how are you feeling about the boys being gone? And big change at the house, huh? Well, certainly we missed them. But most importantly, I just want to thank Tom Decker. Because Tom called recently, and he may have reached out to a number of parents here, about picking up the pictures over by the upper school gym of the seniors that were being rotated out. And I came home, and I guess Roseanne clearly went and got those pictures, because now they're prominently displayed at our kitchen table. I suspect they'll probably be there for most of the semester. But there is some good news. I sat there now for several dinners, and well, these pictures don't talk back. And neither one of these pictures has got angry at me when I've asked them where they're going or where they're going to come home. So really, we're off to a good start. I've been on the board now for, this will actually be my 11th year. And last year I agreed to take the presidential baton, if you will, from Lou Paglia. Lou is a hard act to follow. Lou's thoughtful, generous nature really set a high bar for all of us as trustees. Unfortunately, you know, Lou couldn't be here tonight, but I really wanted to thank Lou for all the time and energy that Lou's given to King. So as we discussed tonight, I'm going to talk about legacy. The legacy as parents we can leave behind here at King. First, though, I thought I'd spend just some time discussing the role of the board, as it will help set the stage for the discussion around legacy. Also, I'm often asked, Tom, what does the board do? What is the role of the board here at King? And so I'm somebody who really likes to be very open and transparent, so I thought we'd talk a little bit about what the board does, and then I'll tie that back to legacy. So as you can see, here's some of the summary items of the role of the board here at King. First, keeping true to the mission of King. As trustees, we need to understand and support the mission of the school, and our decisions and the policies that we make have to support that mission. Our governance is guided by a common sense approach, but most importantly, respecting our culture and caring deeply about what we know as King virtues. And those King virtues are integrity, kindness, perseverance, and respect. Strategic planning and annual goal setting, very critical part of what the board tries to accomplish. One of the things that I think best defines the successes that we have at the board level, and I'm going to touch on this more in a minute. Financial oversight, you heard from Kim the strong financial position that we're in as a school. We at the board, through our finance committee and through the investment committee, work very close with Kim and the administration to oversee and supervise our financial position. Of course, philanthropy. Philanthropy and fundraising, very critical to a private school. Our board leads the way with annual fund giving, has led the way with capital campaigns, and leads the way with endowment support. And then, of course, and my favorite, the board is responsible for managing Tom. It's one of the more fun functions. But seriously, the board is really responsible for evaluating Tom, compensating Tom, but from my perspective, the most important thing, being a sounding board for Tom and helping Tom manage the school. To accomplish these, we have several standing committees to help us essentially, and the committees do most of the day-to-day work of the board. And you can see the committees, executive, trusteeship, which is what invites people to be members of the board, finance, as we discussed, advancement, which is really around capital raising, marketing, and the cultivation of that capital raising, strategic planning, which I'll discuss more, audit, building, and grounds. And those are the standing committees that really do most of the work of the board. Occasionally, we also create task forces. The task forces really allow us to focus on specific items that we might want to enhance or policies that we may want to change. In fact, last year we began an athletic strategic task force, which came up with the framework for a strategic plan that Marnie and Tom Decker and others involved with athletics are focused on right now. And this year we're going to do a task force on financial aid. And many people on the board and in the administration worked very hard this summer on a marketing task force, which will continue into the school year. Now, as I mentioned earlier, strategic planning is critical to the effective functioning of the board. To remain true to our mission and to the vision for our school, we are guided by the strategic plan. Currently, we're in the third year of a five-year strategic plan, and our steady strategic planning over the past decade has really given us the ability to take a long-term view, create ambitious plans, and then set goals annually to make sure we achieve those plans. Each year, our strategic planning committee, working closely with Tom Main and the administration in the school, develop a list of annual goals. These goals are then vetted through and voted on by the broader board. The goals are organized into three categories: board goals, administrative goals, and shared goals. And those shared goals are really goals that the administration and board are going to work most closely on together. I've highlighted some of the goals over the past couple of years. I thought it might be helpful for you to get a sense of what we're thinking about at the board and school level. Certainly, we've done a great job on full-year studies and thinking about the planning around computer science. Many of your children may now be involved with that computer science program, which started about 3 or 4 years ago. We've looked very hard at math and science. I mentioned the athletic departments. Very important to the way we think about things here at King, and certainly Kim touched on the financial side, is really creating a framework to steadily improve our faculty compensation. I'm sure everybody in this room, especially the teachers, would agree that compensating and creating, evaluating, attracting, retaining the absolute best teachers for our students, I can't think of something more important to the people in this room. Developing our character virtues. I think that was a terrific thing to go through as a board and go through as a school. And I mentioned the virtues just before. And then, of course, Kim showed you the transformation of the campus. I mean, over the last 10 years, just incredible. I often tell the story because I was very involved with the field that we built, you know, almost 10 years ago. I got a call. I was on Buildings and Grounds at the time. And I get a call at work. Tom, you got to come over here. It's going to cost a little bit more. I'm like, cost a little bit more? Why? What's going on? Well, there's a 14-foot elevation difference from one side of the field to the other. I'm like, come on, there's no way. Sure enough, so if you ever wonder why we have the retaining wall on the one side and sort of the dugout wall on the other, literally, there was a 14-foot elevation difference. But I've told the story before. Tom Maness absolutely assures me that we took the coin flips. We knew in that first quarter we went downhill. So I don't know if that's true or not because, you know, so, you know, many of you probably know, but not too long ago, NEASC, which is the New England Association of Schools and Colleges, they came in and they reviewed our accreditation. And the primary function of that accreditation is school improvement. We received really a very strong report, something we can be very proud of. But one comment that was not in the report, and that I really think is worth sharing, was from the co-chair of that committee, John Fix. And John is the head currently of the Country School in Madison, Connecticut, and previously he was the head at Chase Collegiate up in Waterbury, and also the head of the Lexington School in Kentucky. And I think the comment speaks directly to the effectiveness of our strategic planning and how aggressive we really have been with our goals. So in an initial meeting with Tom, what John said, I can't think of another school in Connecticut that has done as much to solidify, clarify, and enhance its brand, market position, and program over the last 10 years than King. And what I think is most important, and all of it focused on continuing to develop what is best for students. High praise indeed from a highly respected school head, and he tells me Tom Maine did not bribe him. So this was his own thought. And then in the end, the committee commented very positively on our culture of relentless improvement as a defining feature of our school. So certainly a report that we can be very proud of. So I'm supposed to talk about legacy, so you're probably wondering. So let me tie this all back to legacy and what we can do as parents. We have clearly accomplished a lot here at King over the last 10 years, and now we must continue that momentum. As you've heard from Kim, the annual fund is critical to the success of our programs and attracting and retaining the very best teachers. Kim wanted to highlight, but the slide didn't come up, so I think I stole your slide, yes. So now I'm highlighting on behalf of Kim. Thank you, Ben. Kim highlighted our record success last year at the annual fund, and this year we have another aggressive goal of $2.5 million. I'm sure, as in past years, the board will do its part and lead the way. The past few years, in fact, the board has played a leadership role, and we've always had 100% participation from the board. But when we think about the annual fund, I thought I'd give you a sense of where we've come from. So you can see here, in 2003, we were dead last on a per student basis. I think at that point it was about $1,200 per student. In 2014, you can see we've had steady progress and done much better. And in fact, on a comparison data, we were $2,900 per student. So we've obviously made big strides. And in fact, this is 2014 data, because that's the comparison and peer school data that we have available to us at this point. But as you can see from the slide earlier, we're actually at $3,300 a student now. So we've made incredible progress with the annual fund over 10 years. And really, that's all ties back to the strategic planning effort. On an absolute growth basis, as you can see, significant growth, especially from 2008 to today. As we mentioned, we had a record year last year, and our strategic plan calls for a goal in the 2017-2018 year to hopefully get the annual fund to $3 million. Again, the goal this year being $2.5 million. So Kim talked about the endowment, and as importantly, today we need to focus on our endowment. As Kim explained, our endowment is currently at $22.2 million on a gross basis and just short of $14 million on a net basis. So while we've made some solid strides in growing our endowment over the past few years, the numbers available to us as of 2014 are similar to where we were with the annual fund back in 2003. Unfortunately, currently on a gross and net basis, we're last. A strong endowment will enable us to take a larger draw and continue to fulfill our mission and fortify our financial position. But simply put, the size of the King Endowment is not commensurate with the school's other achievements, and it's something we really need to focus on. To continue to meet our academic objectives, to continue to recruit and retain exceptional faculty, and to make a King education accessible to all families, our endowment really needs to grow substantially. Another critical part you see, that last bullet point, and another critical part of the endowment, of course, is it serves as an important cash reserve should we, some unforeseen event. So another important function of the endowment. So how are we going to do that? What are the current sources of endowment funding? Well, one thing that's been very, very strong over the last several years, in fact, is our surplus from our operating budget. We've been very fortunate because we've always seemed to be able to exceed our goal as it relates to the annual fund. And also, we've had very good and strong enrollment, and we've surpassed some of our enrollment goals. So that enrollment and annual fund excesses on the operating budget, it's been a policy of the board to put that money into the endowment. So anytime we have a surplus, which we've had, on the budget, that goes into the endowment. Then, earlier this year, we kicked off our anniversary initiative in January of this year. Really, we're trying to capitalize on the opportunity afforded us by the sesquicentennial celebration. The anniversary initiative is an 18-month major gift effort focused on raising funds specifically for the school's endowment. We've had some good success to date, and as of last January, we've raised $3.5 million, which is really thanks to a lot of people in this room. This will continue, and the board's major gift committee will continue to work on the anniversary initiative through June 2016. Another new initiative this year is the Legacy Fund. The objective of this newly created Grade 12 funding initiative is to support the operating budget through the annual fund, of course, but also to grow our endowment through a new fund called the Legacy Fund. We're inviting this year's class of 2016 parents to set a leadership tone philanthropically and to create a model level grade in participation for years to come. And then, of course, the spring event, which will be a lot of fun this year. The Parents Association hosts a gala every other year. And this year, the Legacy Gala will be held in April of 2016. And the proceeds from that event supports the Parents Association Endowment Fund for Scholarships. So those are the current primary ways that we fund the endowment. So as current parents, it's really our turn. We have the opportunity to leave a legacy, to put our stamp and support the school through the annual fund and by supporting strategic endeavors, as you've seen behind me, designed to strengthen our endowment. As part of the 150th celebration this year, we're having a commemorative book written chronicling our history. One of my predecessor board presidents, Peter Reinemann, was asked to describe his thoughts on legacy for the book. I'd like to close tonight with his quote. I think it's especially on target. When you look at the plaques in the middle school and the upper school with the names of the contributors, many of the families never benefited from those improvements. I believe every family at King should feel the same obligation to make it a better place, not for themselves, but for future generations of students. I'd always heard about planting a tree, the shade of which you would never enjoy. King has benefited greatly from practitioners of that sentiment. Hopefully, it will continue to do so in the future. Peter, good job. So now I'm going to turn it over to the star of the night, Tom Main, who did not want to be called the star of the night, by the way. I've talked a lot tonight about what we've all accomplished in the last 10 years. Well, it's been Tom's leadership and Tom's stewardship, most importantly, and the fine work of his administrative team and certainly our wonderful teachers that have made it all possible. So thank you, Tom, for doing a great job. Thank you all for coming tonight. And most importantly, thank you all for choosing King. Good night.
Thank you, Tom C. I'm going to have to spend a little time mulling over what it means that I am fun to manage. Thanks to all of you for being here this evening, a phenomenal turnout. I hope you enjoyed spending a little time in our upper school facility, especially those of you whose children are not yet in the upper school. And for all of you that knew what the upper school was like before all of these renovations, it is very different now. And while it looks about the same as it did this time last year, I'll comment that it is almost fully air-conditioned after a fair amount of work this summer. Given the heat over the last few days, especially Tuesday and Wednesday as we started up, even though it wasn't working perfectly, it is a welcome change. We are quite reasonably, incredibly proud of the transformation of this entire campus over the last 12 years. It's really impressive. My wife, Eilish, who's in the second row right here, and I have been a part of this community now for 14 years. And we have three children, two King graduates, one in college now, a sophomore, and one a recent college graduate, and as of precisely 6.5 weeks ago, an employed college graduate. We have one left in the middle school, just to keep us on our toes for the next 5 years. Her focus is clear. Number one, let's make it to the upper school. And number two, when is her big sister going to move out so that she can swoop down and take over the best kid room in the house? Eilish and I are very, very proud of our children, and no small part of that is what they've accomplished here at King. This evening is a significant annual touchstone event for our school, and I'd like to begin by recognizing a number of groups. First, all the members of our senior administrative room, our senior cabinet, who are here. This is the team that really manages the school day to day. If you could all please stand for a minute. Senior cabinet. In the back up there. And I'll point to one individual specifically because he is new to the team and the school, and it's good to put a name to a face. Chris Cunningham, who is the head of our middle school. Where are you, Chris? I would also like to recognize all faculty, administrators, and staff that are in the room, speckled around here. If you could stand for a minute. Anybody else? There we go. And I'll point to one person specifically here, Joe Runge, our Director of College Counseling, who is also new to our school. Where's Joe? Way in the back. Way in the back. Next year, I'm going to ask them all to stand in the, to sit in the front. I think that would be much easier. I'll also ask all of our trustees to stand for a minute, everybody that is a member of our Board of Trustees. Thank you. This is a thoughtful, hardworking group. They do so much for our school. We really are fortunate to have them. So on to my formal remarks. Last year, if you recall, I spent quite a bit of time describing an experience at Smitty's Ice Cream Shack up on the Cape. Good story. I described a tension that exists as our kids pull away from us hard and forcefully, how painful that can be, while simultaneously recognizing how much they need us. This creates an emotional pinball experience in which there are sudden, unpredictable moves which can be highly impactful and highly emotionally draining. In case you're wondering, in this analogy, we are the ball. I'm going to elaborate on that point tonight with a story about a car, this car. My wife and I get a call early this summer from Ryan, 20 years old. He was driving a lot, One of his summer jobs was selling Cutco knives. I bet 90% of you have Cutco knives at home. He calls and says the car has overheated. I meet him. We check the oil. It's empty. No oil. I ask Ryan if there was anything he noticed prior to the overheating. He said, well. And you know, in this situation, when your kid says well like that and there's a pause, you need to listen very carefully to what is about to come out of his mouth. And he said, well, the red oil light was on for a month or so. But, you know, I figured the next time we took it into servicing, we'd take care of it. Interesting answer. Remaining calm was a challenge. The pinball analogy works here. We began a long process of getting to the root of the problem. We took it to our local service station 3 times. First time, they filled it with oil. That should work. It overheated again. Second time, they flushed the cooling system. That should work. It overheated again. Third time, they replaced all the hoses. That should work. It overheated again. We're 3 weeks in at this point. So I figured I needed to go to the source, the dealership where we bought the car. We take it there. First time, found out it was late for routine servicing, plus needed tires and brakes, and replaced all the fluid again. It overheated again. Second time, they had it this time. They figured it out. They replaced all the thermostats. That should do it. It overheated again. Third time, visit 6 now. They have it and they inspect it for 3 days. They call. It's the engine head. It has a slight warp and it needs replacing. A head is ordered. It takes 4 weeks to arrive. Finally, the car is back on the road, running better than ever, as it should, because it's really a very good car. Here's the point. Getting Ryan's car back on the road was a long slog. It was frustrating, counterintuitive. It did not make sense. Our best efforts didn't help. Here's the analogy. And you guys know I love stretching for these. So here it is. Kids overheat. They keep overheating. They overheat again and again and again. Students, even the most able, struggle. Our kids, motivated and talented kids, they struggle. In fact, good learning is a real struggle. And it takes a certain disposition, curious, interested, unflappable, steady, resilient, to best support our children when they are in these moments. We need to maintain focus, keep a cool head. We should not overreact, nor should we appear disinterested. Their emergencies can't be our emergencies. Their oversights should not be our oversights. Our lens for determining what might be tragic or life-altering should not be their lens. We know better. We can't ignore impending obstacles or pitfalls that they might not see. We can't overheat when they overheat. At our best, we provide pathways for them to find firm ground, chances to cool down, opportunities for greater self-awareness. And it can feel as if they are working against us, resisting our efforts, not acknowledging the red oil light that is staring at them on the dashboard, pushing us farther away and then reeling us in for a minute because they know they'll actually need us when the car stops working. As parents, you need this disposition. When your kids are playing pinball with your emotions, depend on this disposition. Rely on it. Know it's your steady disposition, your willingness to stay with your kids calmly, no matter what, that will provide them the safety, the frame, and the foundation that they actually need so desperately in these moments. I know many of you quite well, and I think this disposition is one of the strengths of our student, of our parent body. As a school and as a faculty, this disposition is one of the defining qualities of King. I have been in independent school education for 32 years, all those years in great schools, and I know a bunch of other schools really well. Many of these schools have great teachers, but ours are just superb. Ours are really something special. We are so proud of the professional community assembled here. I have not seen a group of professionals so resilient, so committed to persevere, to lean on the language of our virtues, particularly in their predisposition to do absolutely everything in their power, going down every avenue, trying every reasonable approach, and doing so in a calm and gentle manner when working to help a student reach his or her potential. When they overheat, we're there. As parents and educators, this disposition is a place we should share, and we don't have to conduct dozens of conferences in order to do it well. We just have to share a disposition and embrace resilience, embrace perseverance. We all need to be curious, interested, unflappable, and steady. And when we share this space, each willing to be a pinball when that's what it takes, each willing to sit with them when they overheat and come up with yet another strategy to stay cool and carry on, if we inhabit this space together, even if we never meet to discuss it, then we'll be working together in a really meaningful way. So I'm going to segue now. I worked for about 3 hours on a good transition and I couldn't figure one out. It's our sesquicentennial year. It's a big deal. We're doing a lot with this anniversary. 150 years the school has been around, or one of our predecessor schools. There they all are. This is something we should all be really proud of. It is a stunning accomplishment. The six major points of focus for the 150th celebration are the commemorative 150-year book, an archives project, a speaker series, the first of whom will be John Chubb, president of NAIS. It was a great coup to get him here. He'll be here on September 24th. Write that down. The 150th Legacy Gala, April 30th. Write that down, too. Our PA does a wonderful job with those. It'll be a lot of fun. The anniversary initiative, which Tom C. talked about for quite a while, focused on the really important job of raising endowment and a real focus on expanded alumni outreach. I have read the book, number one on the list, or at least the most recent draft. It's amazing. One learns a lot reading that book. In particular, it's clear that we have always been a resilient place. We have persevered. Interesting. We have survived recessions and depressions, world wars, merges, moves. We have been all over Fairfield County. Massive enrollment swings, fires that destroyed full buildings, hurricane storm surges that have washed over campus when we were on the coast. This was nice. 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 This was a little alarming, but I'm not worried. Not that. This. We have survived sudden and unexpected deaths of headmasters. That was a little tough read. We've been bought and we've been sold. We have made it through just about every challenge a school could face to get to our 150th year. Resilience, perseverance, it's in our DNA. Additionally, the book makes it clear that we have a long history of superb teaching with a 150-year through line of deep commitment to the individual, an institutional disposition that values each child. Our heels are planted on a foundational history that is far deeper and more substantive than so many schools, including all the schools that surround us. We should take great pride in that. We should also appreciate the fact that we are now, today, at one of the strongest and robust times in our historical life. We are doing so many things so well for so many great students. We certainly are honoring our past in our present. We are going strong at 150. Today, we take pride in the fact that we strive to understand where education is going. What are the best practices? What are the best programs? What are the best experiences that will serve that end? The lead line of our mission, which I absolutely love, is powerful. King is dedicated to preparing its students to thrive in a rapidly changing world. There are three macro approaches to meeting this mission that are simple to capture. The first is our development of a team of all school programs, which is in addition to our traditional academic departments. This group works closely with Alex Weiner, Associate Head, and Lise Lease, Dean of Community Affairs, to assure coordination of program and the ability to really capitalize on where they overlap. These pre-K to 12 programs have strong leadership and both standalone programming and deep academic integration. It's a concrete and visible manner. through established and funded programs. You just won't see this sort of commitment in lots of schools. Next, a close review of our approach to academic departments reveals the ascension of our department heads to impactful school-wide academic leaders with a strong hand in the development and coordination of program, hiring, and evaluation. Our tremendous growth in computer science. 3 years ago, we had no one enrolled in computer science. This year, this fall, we have 85 students, a quarter of our student body, enrolled in 8 computer science classes. And our recent strategic planning for the development of both science and math. The coordination of all of this with our enhanced approach to STEM really serves as great evidence for the success of these efforts, which are all efforts tilted towards the mission ideal of preparing our kids to thrive in a rapidly changing world. And finally, a look at our strategic plan, a board document which has been alluded to and referenced already this evening that guides our institutional development. This document reveals a deep commitment to developing in 3 ways: educational excellence, our culture of civility, respect, and service, and institutional strength. Our board is committed to the strategic and steady growth of the school, building on our strengths and creating community and program that will indeed prepare kids to thrive in a rapidly changing world. It is, in fact, the board's steadfast commitment to strategic planning that has allowed us to develop in the ways I've just described. So we're a school with a long tradition of academic excellence, no doubt about that. We are deeply connected to our mission, core values, and virtues. We are developing in a strategic manner, academically, educationally, and as a community. We are able to do so and have been able to do so for 150 years because we are strong and resilient and deeply committed to each child in our care. We have great respect for the delicate journey that is human development, with all of its complexities and all of the opportunities that it brings to our students. We're not put off visiting the mechanic 6 times to sort out the car. Yeah, got back to that, didn't I? Finally, in discussing pride, I will say that we are most proud of our students, every one of them. We have great kids here, interested, accomplished, polite almost all the time, diverse, kind, thoughtful. I could go on forever. They are just the best kids. We love them. I love them. They make my day every day. Two quick examples of how they make my day. I could do 10 of these every single day. This morning, after a long series of meetings, I walked out into the hallway in the lower school, and there was a 4th grader staring at me, hands on his hips, head askew, and he demanded of me, "Mr. Main, is it going to rain at recess today? Because you know that it will not make me happy if it does." I tried. The same morning, in the 2nd grade, a little boy with a great smile listens while a teacher explains that this is the 150th birthday of the school. He thinks for a moment, and then he asks, seriously, "Does that mean that Mr. Main is 150 years old?" Can't make that up. So I want to thank you for coming this evening. It was a great night. You were a great audience. And now I'm going to ask that you join us in a tradition of ringing the bells. Let me describe that tradition while the bells are passed out. And I'm going to talk really loud because we're going to hear a little bit of ringing. At the beginning of every year, we have an assembly with all 700 kids, all 150 employees. And at the end of that assembly, about 35 bells are handed out, and the entire student body rings in the school year. And it's just a great tradition. At the end of the school year, when the seniors graduate and they recess, there's a table that they walk by, and each one of them picks up a bell that has the seal of the school on it and their graduation date. They grab it, they get to keep it, and they make a heck of a racket as they ring themselves out for one last time, as they've been ringing themselves in year after year after year. So the bells are all now distributed. And so what I am going to ask you to do is to make as much noise as you can by passing those bells around as we ring out 150 years and we ring in the next 150 years. And when you start doing that, the event is over. I'm not going to say anything else. All right? So please, make some noise.